fear him reverently and respectfully. If the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the sinner and the ungodly appear? Hey, if the righteous scarcely get in by the hair of our heads, so to speak, for those that are playing around, you ain't got a snowball in hell chance with playing around. And I believe that God is calling in this hour to clean up our acts. Because let me tell you something, nothing's hid from God. But you know, people can tell when you're playing games. You can't kid people that are seeing for what it is. God is calling to a people to come out from amongst them and be ye separate, saith the Lord. One reason the world's on its way to hell right now and this church is not packed out because they've looked at enough sorry, low-down things that are called Christianity and they want nothing to do with it.
Amen.
Because it's no different than the world.
Hallelujah.
And God's going to judge it, brother.
Yes, he will.
He's going to judge it.
Hallelujah.
He's going to judge it. Not only will we, the church, stand at the judgment seat of Christ, we are going to stand at the judgment seat of Christ and give an account for every word, every deed. Your book, your life is an open book being recorded right now. So is mine. Sister Debbie Dean, it scares me enough. I want to get this thing right. My brother Reese is going to stand before God and give an account for every sermon, for every testimony, for every witness, for every action, for everyday life. I'm going to give an account. And I'm going to tell you something that scares me enough. I want to get my act together.
Yes.
And then there's the great white throne judgment. The book of Revelation speaks of Revelation chapter 12, I believe it is. The great white throne judgment is for the damned and the wicked. That's for those that are evil, lost, undone, without God, that will be pulled up out of the pits of hell, and every single wicked soul that's ever went to hell is going to stand before the great white throne judgment of God, and the books are going to be opened, and they're going to have a righteous courtroom trial set up, and for every accuser that God has judged them wrongly, their lives will be open book season right there at the great white throne judgment, and everything will be there. I know what I'm talking about. It's not one judgment for the righteous and the wicked. There's two different ones. Some preach it all, but it's not. The great white throne is for those that have gone straight to hell, and they will be pulled out of hell. The Bible says death and hell will give up. But we, the church, is going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ as his bride, and we are going to be judged for the works we've done and the motives that we've done. You know, I want to say this. Don't run off and do something for God and then strut around like a stinking rooster with your feathers stuck out, crowing every time you get a chance about what I did. If you're going to do it as unto God and leave it there.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Because he sees the motive of the heart. Why do you think when he said, on that day, many will come and say, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Did we not cast out devils? Did we not this and this and this and that? And he's going to say, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I never knew you. You want to know why he said that? Because he knows whether he's got your heart or not. Or you just some showboat wanting to show your little showboat. And God's not in 100 miles of your heart. This is the kind of stuff that strips us down naked before God and gets us real. And I've seen so much showboat, man, I'm telling you the truth. I've seen so much showboat in these years of ministry and things that the people's done. And when they don't get their glory, look out, well, all hell breaks loose. Everything I want to do, I want my motives to be as unto God.
Amen.
As unto God.
Amen.
As unto God.
Amen.
But it's the little foxes that spoil the vines, the Bible says. The little unattended, unsurrendered, undealt with things that spoil the vines, saith the Lord. And I'm going to tell you something, church. We better get it dealt with. Because the Bible says that a little leaven leaveth the whole lump. Don't take much leaven to leaven the whole loaf. So these little things, if they're not dealt with, sooner or later, Satan's going to expand them in your life. Stinking thinking, bad attitude, disobedience, won't submit, won't come under any accountability, and got disrespect for the authority of the house of God.
Amen.
Yeah. God, when you walk in blatant disrespect, when the man of God instructs and teaches and tries to bring the flock along, and you've got this attitude that you're not going to listen and you're going to form your own opinion, you know, what are you, a sheep or a goat? And I see so much rebellion in the body of Christ. And Donna was talking about it today. No wonder in America right now, statistics show that over 1,500 clergy each month, and the number's even higher right now, over 1,500 a month in America is walking away from the pulpits. Because what should be the body of Christ is trying to devour the shepherds and gut them and leave them for dead. Amen. Because they will not submit to the authority God has placed in their lives.
Amen.
You know, I tell people, I'm one tight ship preacher, buddy. And I mean, when I pastor, I run a tight ship. If you won't pay your tithes and you won't be faithful to the house of God, when all hell is breaking loose, then don't expect me to be faithful to you either.
Yes.
Amen.
Because I don't have time to entertain a bunch of rebellious people that are not going to submit to the will of God.
Amen.
When you can't pay your light bill and you won't pay a dime to see the kingdom of God and the appropriation of the gospel further, then don't bellyache to me about it. You've got a curse on your finances.
That's right.
And when you're taking kingdom money and you buy your cigarettes and your lottery tickets and every stinking thing like that, you are taking what God, amen, has given to you and trusted you with it, and you're throwing it to the winds of the world, and God can't bless it because the Bible calls it bags with holes in it.
Amen. That's right.
I didn't know all this was coming out, but prophets can get pretty tight sometimes. I'm not afraid to do it.
Praise the Lord.
So I'm going to be blessed. And you know, where Don and I live, man, our lives are open books in my neighborhood. I ain't got nothing to hide. Ain't no pornography books hid up under my mattress. Ain't no beer cans hid nowhere. And all this junk that we slip around and we hide and we don't get on the computer and think, ain't nobody around, I'll hit this website real quick. But there's an eye. There's an eye.
That's right.
There's an eye.
There's an
eye. An all-seeing eye. And nothing escapes that eye.
Amen.
I don't know who this is for tonight, and you may be mad at the wet end when you go home and go to Rigsby, but there's a remedy. It's called repent and get right with God. You can have peace with God.
Amen.
And you can't accuse me of being intolerant or anything like that, because sometimes what's a good dose of conviction is not intolerance. You need to get right with God.
Amen.
And a little sick of that old flame barking every now and then. Well, you're just intolerant. I'm intolerant of a low-down devil and what he's doing, yeah.
Yes.
And you'll never, ever hear me preach greasy, slippery grace. I believe in grace in all its fullness, but it is not licensed to live any way we want and trample our feet on top of grace. Grace is the unmerited, unmerited favor of God that we never did deserve it. We didn't pay for it. We don't have nothing to do with it. It's the gift of God, and we ought to cherish it and honor it.
Amen.
I'm a little bit weary of these slippery tongue preachers preaching grace and grace that we can do whatever, say whatever, go wherever, and live with whatever, and shack up and do whatever, and we're all going to grease right on in the gates of heaven. Gonna be a bunch of preachers burning hell with that.
That's exactly right.
Well, that'll get me fired. But you didn't hire me, honey, so you can't fire me. We sit down at our TVs, and I put my own hide, and sometimes stuff rolls on TVs, and some God is hell. Blaspheme in the name of God, and you can't even turn the TV on show now or television program on if some woman's hind end ain't hanging, shining. And they make little insinuations about the Lord, and I mean, Hollywood, God's good. You better know Hollywood's going to judge California, all right. You better know judgment's going to hit out there in Hollywood one day more than they want, because they have blasphemed, and in this hour they're blaspheming the things of God like I've never seen. But you hang on. You hang on. You hang on. Because
yes.
The Bible says God is not mocked. Be not deceived. Yes. But a man sows that will he also reap.
Amen.
It's a fearful thing to fall in the hands of a living God. And it's coming, church. It's coming. They'll wave their colors and their little gay colors and gay flags and all this stuff. But you hang on. God's going to deal with it.
Amen.
Amen.
Anyway. You say, You're being mean. No, I'm not. I've got an indignation against the enemy.
That's right.
You want real freedom? Get the little foxes out of the vineyard.
Amen.
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 Come on. Amen. See, in almost 25 years of ministry, I've heard people stand up and test a lie when it should have been a testify, but it wasn't up but a test a lie. And I'm not saying y'all stood and told any lies, but I hear people do that stuff when the Lord says, look at that. And people want to be freer and freer. And some of y'all want to be anointed, but get the fox out of the vineyard.
Amen.
I'm not going to trust the great vineyard to you when you are allowing the foxes to spoil it up. Ecclesiastes 10 talks about dead flies in the anointing.
Yep.
Dead flies or dead bugs in the anointing of the apothecary. Let me explain it to you tonight. That's an overseer that oversees the ointments next to the temple house. And it was his job to make sure the bugs never got in the ointment or the oil, Sister Abedin, because if bugs or dead flies or flies flew into those ointments and they stayed there long enough, they put off a stinking aroma, and it was no longer useful to be used in the temple to offer up a sweet-smelling savor in the nostrils of God. I'm telling you, dead things in your life, honey, does not send off the fragrance of heaven. It sends off a stink, and God wants it out of your life.
Yeah.
That'll preach.
Preach anywhere.
And I want the sweetness of the wonder why that brother Rixby, man, he's anointed and he's with it. But I'll tell you something. I've paid a price for the anointing of God. I've had to die 10,000 times over. Not been right.
Amen.
And let me jack up your foundation, honey. It's not Brother Walls' church, and it's not your church. It's his church.
Amen.
I'll tell you why I love stuff down, Brother Mike, right now. Because we're putting our hands on it, and we're calling it ours, and we're giving it to Big Eye. Tracks, brother. You see, this is what a lot of us do.
Yes.
We come and we nonchalant throw up our thing. Well, we done got a justice. And we turn our back and we walk away.
Yes.
But one thing, yes, Pastor, you came before the king with your head bowed in reverence.
Yes.
And you never turned your back and walked away.
No.
Never. And they stopped me in my tracks. And even before I got to the wall, they said, "You must cover head. You must cover head." So they made me put on one of these little kipper things. And because the Bible says it's a shame for a man to pray with his head uncovered. And it's a shame, amen, for a woman, amen, to not have her hair covered and all that. But let me tell you something, a woman can pray without a cap on her head or something on her head because her hair is her covering. Let me tell you something. Sister Donna, hallelujah, she's got her covering. Knows? Right here's her covering. I'm her husband. I'm her covering. But let me tell you something. If I go before God, if we want to get technical about it, and I pray and I'm never covered, I'm basically saying I'm my own covering, not God. But we should be clothed with a spiritual covering.
Amen.
And when we come before God, letting Him know you're my covering.
Hallelujah.
He's my covering. I'm her covering. And God is her covering. So when I went to turn and walk away from the wall, they stopped me. They said, you don't do that. You don't do that. You must walk away backwards. Don't you know that you are in the presence of Jehovah Terah, Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Nisi, Jehovah. You're in the presence of God Almighty. Don't turn your back.
Come
on. And I turned around at the wall and I said, "God, I'm sorry. I didn't." And boy, I just backed away. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. And I walked all the way across the courtyard and out of the courted area, giving God praise and thanks. But I never thumped my nose again in the presence of God and let Him think He's doing me a favor. Christ of salvation to come before Him and respect Him as a king.
Amen. That's right. Hallelujah.
Can you say amen?
Amen.
This wasn't in the program tonight, I assure you, by any means. Let me give you a little story here. Before we close tonight, just to knock the starch out of it.
Johnny.
If you'll get real with the Lord. You see, sometimes we think we're like children in a daycare. And God sees all the facade. He knows the clod. He sees the facade, but yet He still loves the clod. And you and I are made from the dust of the earth. In Daniel chapter 1, when we read the story of Daniel, and what I was going to preach on tonight, being problem solvers or problem causers. Let me say it again, because I didn't get no amen out of that. Being problem solvers are being problem causers.
Amen.
And I'm telling you the truth, I am weary with problem causers.
Amen.
But Brother Wally, I love to be around people that know how to solve a problem and get it out of the way as soon as possible. Because
yeah.
I just don't like problems. I like the unity of the Spirit. It just makes life a lot easier. So you can be a problem solver. Say that with me. I can be a problem solver. Or I can be a problem causer. You know, and I had this one preacher friend, and boy, I tell you what, he just He did, man, I wasn't ever counseling with that fella. He'd just say some of the dumbest things and just hurt people. And let me tell you something. It does matter what you say to people.
Yes, it
does matter. And some of this silly, stupid joking and goofing that goes on in the house of God needs to stop.
Amen.
Because people's feelings are getting hurt. And they're turning from the house of God when they ought to come in and hear the sweet melodies of God's praise. And some of this nonsense ought to stop. But Daniel was a problem solver. Can you say amen?
Amen.
He was a problem solver. And he knew how to head off things that was fixing to cause chaos. He knew how to get into a problem that would keep people from getting killed. And let me tell you something. Another thing that when you come before a king unannounced, and if he didn't have mercy on you in that day and time, and he really didn't see your humility, let me tell you something. If he did not lift down his sepulcher and touch you on the head, you were one dead joker.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
I know in the book.
Right.
But if he saw humility and he had compassion on your petition, that's what he would do. He would run down his sepulcher and touch you on the head. But if he didn't take it down, you know what they did? The rulers come and drug you off, and you ended up with no head. But the Bible says in Daniel chapter 1, when the children of Israel was brought captivity, our captive from Judah, says, and now among these were the children of Judah, Daniel, Ananiah, Mahashiah, and Zechariah, and unto them, and unto whom the prince of the eunuchs gave names, for he gave Daniel the name of Belteshazzar. And the reason the king done this stuff is because he gave them pagan names because he didn't want them worshiping any other deity.
That's right.
Come on.
He didn't want them worshiping any other god but the gods of Babylon.
That's right.
And Belteshazzar, you know, it means the keeper of the moon god. But did you know the name Daniel means God is judge?
Yeah. Yeah.
It means God is judge.
Yeah.
So they appointed him not the moon god. They appointed Daniel to be one that respected the idol of Obel, which was the chief deity of Babylon in that day and time. But Daniel didn't like his pagan name. But we in America, we are satisfied with some of the pagan names we're given and the thing the enemy puts on us, and we just count it off as that's as good as it gets, and this is as better as I'll ever be. But let me tell you something. God's got a name for his church. It's called the Saints of the Most High God.
Amen.
I ain't no saint. Well, if you ain't no saint, what are you?
Amen.
If you ain't a saint, you a heathen.
Amen.
It's tight, but it's right. So Daniel didn't like his name. Ananias, meaning the gift of the Lord. This was one of the Hebrew children. The gift of the Lord. Mishael, meaning what is God? Or Mashal, what is God? Renamed Meshach, and it was his job, amen, to watch over the pagan god Esku. They have some stupid names, I can tell you that. Esku. If that's how you pronounce it, A-K-U. Figure it out for yourself. And then there's Azariah, meaning whom Jehovah helps, renamed Abednego, the servant of Nego, amen, which was the god of senses and literature, which was a big deal in that day and time, the senses and literature. And every time, even in Joseph's day, how many knows that God promoted Joseph in such a way when Pharaoh had a problem, he stopped calling for the mighty counselors of Egypt. You know what he done? He called on a Hebrew slave. When Pharaoh had a problem, he called on Joseph. When Nebuchadnezzar had a problem, he called on the dreamers. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. When Nebuchadnezzar had a problem and he needed a dream interpreted, he called on Daniel, the Hebrew slave. The king of Egypt called on the Hebrew slave. How many knows me and you, we are supposed to be the people that solve problems and not cause problems. But oftentimes, we don't get our way. We raise $900 for my hell and we cause more trouble than a little bit, but it's time to solve the problem. You know, when we've been set free from temptations and things that so easily beset us, our biggest fault is we leave a forwarding address to where we went to. And here comes the little foxes right behind us, and they find us at our forwarding address. And
yeah, boy.
Come on in. Pop the top again. Flip the book open again. Punch the button again. Run that bucket mouth again. Let that tongue grow 14 foot again.
Yeah.
And it all starts over again because we left a forwarding address to where sin can find us.
Amen.
Won't be a soul here anymore, but it will. We need to stop leaving the forwarding address of these things that hinder us and say enough is enough and slam the picking door and say we're done. Can you say amen?
Amen?
But we need to be people of vision, because people of vision know just how to solve problems. They know how, when everything's going unraveled all around them, how even with the counsel of God and the mindset of God's wisdom, we can get this thing solved. But I'm going to tell you what, the Islamist world is uniting and growing in leaps and bounds. The Buddhism is growing. All the pagans are growing. And the occult, the false prophets, and we're sitting around nitpicking everything we can. I don't like the carpet. I don't believe the parking lot is right. Or I don't like the chair. Or I don't like this. I don't like the lights. You change the name of the church. Who gives a flip? Let's get her done. So the trumpet will sound. Come on. I ain't going to bring those in your church. Pastor Walls, change the name. Well, why don't you go get your huggies off and put some fluted balloons on? Grow up and be a man, bless God. Get your lace panties off, wimp. Proverbs 29:18 tells us, where there's no vision, the people perish.
Yeah, that's right.
Let me tell you something. I don't care if people get mad. Sometimes people need to get mad so they'll realize what a stupor they're in and the mess they're causing.
Amen.
And say amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
I've seen things like, well, the pastor didn't call on me to pray tonight. That's my job to pray. Or the pastor didn't ask me to do the ushering. Or the pastor didn't have me to pass the plate. Or that's my job. That's my job. That's my job. Sometimes God's going to try you to see where your humility's at.
Come on,
man. Let me tell you something. The first time, here I am called to be a preacher, but the first time I was ever asked to get in the bathroom and clean the stinking toilets in the church, I went and got me a scrub a dub dub and I cleaned the toilets and I said, glory to God. Oh, no. That's not where the neighbor's at. That's not where I can toot, toot, toot my horn. I want to be up here where I can be seen. I want to be up here where I can speak and I can make noise and be seen. But sometimes you need to shut up and learn humility and get right with it. Position.
Good. Come on.
Sometimes I'd like to line some people up at the altar, amen, and take them out of Granny's old-fashioned hickory switch and tear some hind ends up. God bless God. I can understand why Jesus cleaned the temple out. The Bible says in Habakkuk 2:1, I will stand up on my watch, and I will set me up on the tower, and I will watch and see what he shall say unto me, and what I shall answer when I am reproved.
Amen.
See, we're living in a generation that don't want to be reproved, don't want to be rebuked, and don't want to be corrected. You're going to say amen, bless God. You know I'm telling the truth.
Amen.
I've been a pastor. I know how people operate. Oh, man, as long as you got them hanging off the lights and the chandeliers and the monkeys are running the show and the monkeys are running the zoo, everything's okay. But somebody's got to be a keeper of the zoo or you're going to have total stinking chaos.
Amen.
And hey, Washington, you need to shut up. You're running the whole country like a bunch of monkeys and get some people in Washington that's got some sense.
Amen.
Verse 2 says, and the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon tablets or upon a table or tablets, Andy, that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but the end shall speak, and it shall not lie. Hallelujah. Though it tarry, you know, the Bible says, wait for it, because it will surely come, and it will not tarry. Behold, his soul, which is lifted up in him, amen, is not upright in him, but the just shall live by faith.
Amen.
Amen.
People of vision, amen. Hallelujah. Don't entertain and be caught up by the trivials of life. People of vision, amen, will not settle for less. That's the reason I've had people to get try to get to me before I get in pulpits, Brother Wally, yeah, and tell me this and tell me that and do all their pity party stuff and nitpick. And I'm just like, there's the altar right there. There's the problem place. There's the song right there. There's the place that can be reconciled. There's the place where we can get it right. I don't want to go there.
Amen.
No, what you want to do is make everybody in the county their ears garbage cans. Let me tell you something. These are garbage cans.
Come on.
So people of vision don't settle for less. Can you say amen?
Amen.
People of vision, amen, know there's more to come. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. They know there's more to come. Glory to God. Say that with me. I know there's more to come. Fighting you tooth and nail, because he knows, amen, that there's more coming, and he's scared of it, he's frightful of it, he's worried about it, because when this thing hits and God gets the people right and ready, whoa, the trumpet's going to sound. So people of vision know there's more to do. People of vision know there's more to do. First lady back here, and that's how I treat her. She's first lady. He's pastor. She's first lady. They're not your garbage can. They're not dogs for you to mistreat and talk about and badmouth and make every stupid little joke when they come into church about them. Stop it! They're the priest of God! Stop it!
Amen.
Come on, brother. If you disrespect me, I'll shut you down so fast make your picking hands swim.
Amen.
Because I am called of God, and Psalms 105:15 tells you flat out, you better shut your mouth, touch not God's anointed, and do his prophets no harm. I'm going to tell you one day, I know three people in a stinking graveyard right tonight because they put their mouth on me and I warned them to repent and get right, and they brought cold, starkly taken down the heart attack, and they're in the graveyard tonight because they touched the anointing.
You
can be a fool if you want to, but don't you think God won't deal with it. I stood up in a Ponderosa in Tennessee. God said, when you get through eating, you get up and you preach the gospel. Man, I got up and I got through eating. I had the church family to go outside. Donna stood there with me. I proclaimed the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. That place was packed out. I mean, and there was a group of Muslims over in the corner. I didn't know who they was and what they was and nothing else. But I got up and I proclaimed, amen, the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and the love of God that will save, amen, that will set anybody free. And the owner of the restaurant come out and he started trying to shut me down. He was bad-mouthing me. He was scoffing me and saying things about me. And I looked at him. I said, sir, I'm telling you, it's a dangerous thing to put your mouth on God's anointing, repent and get right. He wouldn't do it. 2 weeks later, he was deader than a mackerel. Or at least 2 weeks later, I found out he got cold turkey dead with a massive heart attack. And he don't own the Ponderosa no more. 3 times I've watched that happen. You see, it's time we grow up and start having some respect.
Amen.
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 People of vision know, amen, there's more, hallelujah, to experience. I'm going to say it again. They know there's more to experience. People of vision know, amen, they know there's more to know. I appreciate Sister Wallace coming up here last night wanting us to pray for her that she may know more about the book.
Amen.
I appreciate that. Because the Bible says that we're not to be an ignorant people. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge or destroyed because of ignorance. Means the same thing. And so people of vision know there's more to believe. I said there's more to believe.
That's right.
I said there's more to believe. People of vision know, amen, there's more to happen. People of vision know there's more to see. People of vision know there's more to hear.
Amen.
They say amen.
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 Ephesians 3:20 tells us, now in the heavens, we've seen it, money above all, we might ask to thank for the power of works in Him. Why? Verse 21 says that Jesus Christ will get glory in the church world without end, or worldwide without end. Jesus Christ should be getting glory in the church. Amen?
Right. Amen.
Should be getting glory in every church on this very block and corner and all over wherever. Every church, amen, when it's open, hallelujah, I'll ring the prayer bells of glory of God.
That's right.
But a lot of them are reproached, and some of them ain't worth the gas it takes to get to them.
Amen.
Amen. Some of them ain't worth the wear and tear it puts on my car to get to them. You want to know why? Because some jacklin in a pulpit that will not preach and will not tell God's people what it's going to take to get there because he's afraid of his billfold. He's afraid of everything in the church. And he's afraid of old Daddy Big Bucks and Daddy Big Mama and Bob 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 and everything. He's afraid of his people. And it's time to start preaching.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
Come on. People of vision are contenders. Say that with me. We're contenders.
Yeah.
When the Apostle Paul wrote the letter, you know, on the Corinthian church, and said we are to contend for the gospel.
Yeah.
A contender, you know, is somebody that gets in there and they fight for it, man. They think of themselves as champions. I look, I'm representing the gospel. I don't have to take that. I don't have to go along with that. You see, right now people are going along to get along. They're just going along to get along. I know I ain't going to preach in a lot of churches, man. I know that. They ain't going to have me because I rock the boat too much.
Amen.
There's a church a few miles from here. I won't call it. Every time I preach there, somebody got saved. Pastor got mad and won't have me back. God is my witness. Every time I preach, people got saved. He got mad and won't let me come back and preach. You want to know why they're not getting saved under your ministry, preacher? Because your weak knee won't preach.
Yeah, come on. Come on, preacher. There you go.
You see, it's the preaching of the gospel in its power and its form that brings conviction to the heart of a sinner. I'm glad the day I got saved, the old preacher wasn't afraid to tell me, you're going to die and go straight to hell if you don't stop running from God.
Yeah.
God's just about dealt with you. There ain't going to be no more dealing. You better seize the moment, redeem the time. The days are evil and your time's running out, honey. You better get it while you can.
Amen.
You got to be saved, I can tell you that.
There you go.
So we're contenders, amen. Contenders. It means to strangle. It means to fight. It means to battle. It means that we are contenders, amen. And the word also means overcomers. Somebody say overcomers.
Overcomers.
That's what it means. We're contenders for the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Luke 21 verse 1 says, David said, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills and come with my help and my help comes from the Lord. He made heaven and earth.
That's true.
Boy, some tight preaching in here tonight.
Amen.
But I just felt, man, you want to know what I feel about this service tonight? That you can sit there with your smile and like, it ain't for me. I'm going to tell you something. You ain't got God, fool. And you may not repent. And you may not see nothing wrong with what you're doing. But the Bible says there's a way that seems right unto man. But the end thereof leadeth unto death. Sleeping with a woman every now and then, unmarried. Ain't nothing wrong with me. Ain't nothing this. Ain't nothing that. I said, keep following it, and you'll live with your eyes in an eternal hell one day.
That's right.
Thinking you're on the showboat to glory. Because some preacher told me. Right? And he's a drug dealer, too. And I said, what's going to become of you if you die? Well, I'm going to heaven. I said, stupid is as stupid does, and stupid is as stupid says. It's one thing for people to think you're stupid. It's another thing when you prove it. And one preacher said, I ain't running with you, Brother Ridgely, man. You just caused too much chaos. You ain't got no church now, neither.
It's true.
But we need people of vision that's willing to deal with the little foxes in our lives. And this church has been through hell for years.
Yes.
And Pastor shared that with me, some of the history of this church. My God. And Satan's so mad right now.
Yep.
He's about to step on his slippery little tongue.
Yes.
He don't want anything to happen here. He's hated this revival. He's fought it every single day that we've been here. He's had his little head stuck up. And everything, but you know what? It's time for we little tenders to draw back our Holy Ghost in and get that sucker right between the eyes and say, get out of my face, devil, and get thee behind me. Because I'm a contender.
Yes.
Amen.
For the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Stand with me tonight. You know, as a prophet, well, sometimes God gives me some tough stuff to preach, man. I'll go home tonight and just about cry myself to sleep at this kind of preaching. But I can't help it. I'm going to give an account. And if you die and miss it, I don't want to stand before God and your blood dripping off my fingers.
No,
says Daddy. Don't want to do it. I want to stand before God and hear the words, well done, thy good and faithful
servant. Amen.
In the name of the joy of thy life.
Amen.
Boy, it's been sobering in here tonight. It's been, sobering, church. Somebody need to hear this tonight. Somebody needs to hear this kind of preaching tonight. You can say what you want about Brother Ridgely, but I advise you to be careful what you say.
Amen.
Yes.
Man, stood up in my church one night, just had a brand new family come in, Sister Aberdeen, with three or four little girls. And I just had opened the service, and I asked for prayer requests for me, Sister Donna. The man said, well, I got something to say. He stood up and he lit into me like a junkyard dog, saying all kind of bad stuff about me. And I just felt a wolf pounce in the congregation. Man, and people were fleeing out the door, and that young family left, and I never saw them again. I looked at that guy, and I told him, I said, you better repent, brother. These things you accused me of are false, and they are lies. And you have no right to say these things about me. You better repent. He didn't repent. And he was a former judge. See, I'm not afraid of the judges, neither. He wouldn't repent. Look at here. Dude fell over dead with a massive heart attack. wouldn't repent. See, we have forgot the repentance. We forgot, as the message come forth, God's concern about the little areas of our lives. As the old saints used to sing, Brother Mike, a 99 and a half won't do. You've got to give 100 if you don't make it through.
Amen.
That's right. I get tired of it. Brother, ain't none of us perfect. And my flesh is always going to war. But did you know when you got saved, your soul was redeemed? Your soul's been made perfect. It's this flesh. You need to line up to the... Your flesh needs to line up to the Spirit, because the Spirit's going to line up to the Word. If you've got the Spirit and the Word activated and going the way it will, the flesh will come along. You see, the flesh don't dictate to you how you're supposed to live, act, talk, and do and say. What it is, the Spirit and the Word is supposed to tell your flesh, shut up, this is what we're going to do.
Amen.
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 But it's time for the flesh to be strengthened. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Because the Bible says the flesh and blood will not enter into the kingdom of heaven. It won't enter in. And the Bible tells us on that day when the trumpet sounds that this old mortal body is going to take on immortality. This old corruptible thing is going to take on incorruption. And then shall we be changed. But church, we've got to be concerned of how we're acting, talking, and living. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
The devil, he going to make lies. The best you do, the devil going to accuse and tell lies on you.
Oh, yeah.
But you know what? When your character and the fruit of the Spirit are lining up to the Word, people are going to say, I don't believe a word of that, because I know they're lying. Can I get a witness, Mr. Phillips?
Amen.
I know their life, and I don't believe it.
Amen.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
So the nice king walked in tonight, and I believe that he came with an indignation, church.
Amen.
We've heard enough preaching this week to save the whole country 50 times over.
Amen.
I have preached my brains out of this place.
Amen. Yes, you have.
Amen.
I've heard a lot of people shouting good timing and all that, but I ain't seen these altars near as filled as they should have been.
No.
And if you think you can drink from the fountain, amen, bitter water and sweet water coming out of the same thing, you've got another thing.
Amen.
There ain't but one fountain that flows from Emmanuel's veins, and it's holy, it's clean, and it's sweet for the soul.
Amen.
Anything else is bitter stuff.
Right.
Tell you what I want to do. Now, if the old saying is, if you can take it, you can make it. If you're here tonight, be willing to meet, brother, ready to beat these altars, every one of them. I got family going straight to hell. I got loved ones going straight to hell. I mean, in a high ball speed. And so do you. And we got things that need to be sharpened up, tuned up, that it's time for the world and Satan that he will quit finding accusations and things to work with and nitpick in our lives. That when he comes up, he's going to see the pure blood, the whole blood of nothing but the blood. Because that's why I plead the blood. The blood, church. The blood. God spoke to me tonight. In Exodus chapter 3, I believe it is. He said, tell my people, they're standing on holy ground. They're standing on holy ground. And why do you think God told Moses to take off your shoes, for the ground in which you stand is holy? Because we wear these things called shoes and socks and all that, and we're wading through a world of muck and filth and garbage every day. But when we come into the presence of God, we're standing on holy ground. He said, get that mess off your feet, because where you stand now is holy.
Amen.
And that's the reason Jesus washed the disciples' feet, because they had waded through the streets of Jerusalem and waded through donkey and dung and all kind of mess in the streets and had it all over their feet and everything, as the people often, you know, went barefooted or did up on their sandals and stuff. And Jesus washed their feet. Why did he do that? Because he wants his people walking right.
Amen.
Humility. Whatever happened to humility? So I'm going to tell you what. Here it is. I'm going to hurry. I want y'all to come up here with me. And I want to pray.